Hi, my name is Ezra Bristow. I identify as he, him, his. I am a 29-year-old Black American artist, a Newark, New Jersey native that has been living in the Bay Area for the last 7 years. And I am a multimedia artist. I started in the tradition of illustration and cartooning, but I'm primarily a dancer and an artist, particularly through the lens of carnival and through Afro-Caribbean and Afro-Brazilian and African-American resistance through joy and the traditions and the histories and the legacies that connect us through this particular celebration of joy. When I think about my scars, I think first and foremost about my skin. I think about being of African descent and also American, because we operate and occupy this very unique space where we are not tied to the land, but our culture is. Our identity is, in a very deep and real way that creates this double consciousness. In 2014, I actually found out that I had vitiligo, and I was just moving to California for the first time. And as a man, I'm just getting to a place where I'm trying to navigate how to be independent, but also in the greater scheme of things, how to have greater self-awareness and self-acceptance. As a kid, my entire educational career has been in predominantly white spaces after going to public school. And so from fourth grade until I graduated college, I was always part of very small minority relative to the student body and the population. On top of that, to then be referred to as the token, or to being told by my cousins, my blood relatives, that I talk white. So I'm not black enough for my relatives, but I'm too black for my friends that see me as a token, as the only link they have to a whole side of American culture that they have no real understanding of or context for. I like anime. I like reading books. I like being out in nature. I like swimming. Oh, black people don't swim. Black people don't go in nature. Black people don't like reading. Black people are lazy. Like all of these tropes. And I'm in a space where there's nobody else that looks like me. So everybody's perception and misconception is immediately put on my skin, and I can feel it. I can feel their eyes on me. Every time someone misrepresented me or perceived me as something other than how I define myself, I was filled with a lot of rage and also a lot of resentment and inferiority complex and insecurities around, well, I have to act a certain way in order to be seen as who I am. I think the person that influenced me the most and continues to do so is absolutely my mother. From a very early age, she made sure that I knew that I was different in every sense of the word. In a good way, I was a gift. I was a blessing. My siblings and I were put here to break curses, generational, familial cycles of dysfunction, to break those generational curses. And at the same time, when you are in these spaces of predominantly white people, at the end of the day, you're still a nigga. It doesn't matter what pedestal they seem to be putting you on. It doesn't matter how talented and articulate you are. It doesn't matter that they act like they like you because you do all these things. Because the minute you, as the poor black kid from the hood that's coming up the hill to their world, do something that they don't like, they will kick you back down the hill. On the flip side, I'm a very sensitive kid at the time. And my mom, who again had to grow up really tough, she would tell me on a regular basis when I was a kid, something to the effect of like, you have to have a thicker skin. Like, you can't take everything so personally. It's like I spent so much of my life wanting to fit in because I was living in that fishbowl of where it's like, you know, I'm always on the inside looking out, and on that one side there's the black folks, on the other side there's the white folks, and then there's everybody else that gets ignored in the dichotomy of black and white. I have always just wanted to experience it all, because to me, that's where that's where home was. It has been an ongoing struggle, but I think the thing that helped me build resilience towards that was a trip I had taken a year before, where I went to Trinidad for 6 months, Trinidad and Tobago for 6 months. During that program, you are expected to participate in what is called Carnival as cultural performance. And it is an investigation and a discovery of this festival that for many people just means beautiful naked bodies in a tropical paradise for X amount of days or months. But for those that are native to that culture and native to that land and native to that experience, it is a rite of passage. It is a ritual of resilience, of resistance, of liberation and emancipation. And also, it is an economic structure. It is built into the economy of Trinidad and Tobago for carnival to exist as part of tourism, but also as part of just celebration and arts and culture and music and food. I grew up listening to soca and dancehall music and gravitating towards that far more than I did to hip-hop, which for all intents and purposes is a more direct link to my artistic and musical heritage and inheritance. But when I landed in Trinidad and saw all shades of people, but so many of them being brown, it felt like home. You know, there's Indo-Trinidadians, Afro-Trinidadians, there's people that are Chinese that are Trinidadian. It's like you still see much of the kind of diaspora that you would see in a place like New York or New Jersey, but because the population is so brown, there's not a question of who you are until you open your mouth. You're one of us. And so having that experience paired with the kind of joy and connection that I'd experienced with this musical and artistic culture, I was able to recognize that the way that I see and experience blackness and the way that people perceive me has fundamentally changed when you step into a space that is not entirely defined by the white supremacy of American culture. Which allowed me to have confidence that when I started to see my skin color changing, that it doesn't mean I'm not black enough. I got to California, and right around the time I moved to California, the spots of vitiligo started showing up. And at first I was terrified, and I was looking for every way that I could fix it, you know? And like I went to a doctor and they were like, basically we're gonna shoot UV light at your face at $100 a session, and we're gonna basically shoot UV light at your face until your skin turns pink. And we're gonna do this once a week for 6 months and maybe something will happen. A, I am a broke artist living in the Bay Area. I'm not spending that kind of money. B, there's stigma attached to tanning and UV light and the potential of cancer. And now I'm thinking about like my history. As a black American, if I have vitiligo, does that mean that those are the white rapist ancestors, their genes are kicking in? Or is it something else? But there's not even enough research about vitiligo, because the most famous examples of vitiligo bleached himself. So now I'm thinking about, what did that do to Michael Jackson to find out he had this thing? And I'm almost positive that there was an immediate, that's not marketable, you look crazy. So he has to bleach his whole body. And the kind of mental and emotional trauma that toll that took on him on top of being a celebrity. There's no examples of what it means to be a melanated person and live with vitiligo. But then you start seeing, and it actually, right around the same time I moved out here, Winnie Harlow became a thing and became popular. And it's like, all right, so there's a model that has advanced vitiligo. And she just embraced it. Despite all of the problems that I've had with being misrepresented and misunderstood or misperceived, I am so proud of my skin color. I'm so proud of, like, during the summers when I get chocolatey. I love being black. I love being melanated in particular. Could I live with that? couple months ago, I was doing a Zoom class, and I'm teaching kids about the history of African American culture, again, through the same lens of the diaspora, teaching them about the history of hip hop and how it was created by youth in New York. And in the middle of me teaching, a student goes, "Do you have vitiligo?" You know, it only takes a second. When you're a teacher, you're kind of on all the time. So I had to prep for a second, just for a second. It was like, yes, I do. And I used me having vitiligo to talk about how no matter what you look like, you have to accept yourself. And I said it to the kids because I knew it was the right thing to say, and I knew it was the best way to address it, allow it to be seen and heard, and then move on. And still, I felt in my spirit that I was also saying it a little bit to convince myself, a little bit to reaffirm that I still am in that process. I think one of the best parts about my parents was that I learned how to laugh about it. I learned how to talk about it. And I think that the story with the student, while I know internally that I'm still processing it, I also recognize that, like, it's a testimony. It's the simple fact that I can talk about it gives me power. The most beautiful and effective part of my journey has absolutely been art. I created a drawing piece in 2015 depicting a black man where one side of his face was black and he was holding his hand covering his face and his hand was completely white, and the other side of his face was like white with, like, you know, the you see blue eye and you see blonde eyebrow, but his hand is completely black. And so it's like one is completely, it looks like one is stuck in white paint, one is stuck in black paint. And that piece was made not to symbolize the physical experience of vitiligo, but the emotional and ideological and psychological experience of being a black man growing up in white America. Because that felt like the juxtaposition I was struggling with was how to feel authentically black when I wasn't stereotypically black. But it put pen to paper, it manifested what that experience was like for me. And there are parts of how I act or how I talk or how I operate that, you know, people feel is indicative of white America. And I'm like, it's American. It's like, I don't speak the Queen's English. We our American English is all kinds of jacked up. But it's American. And I am American. I'm black and I'm proud to be black, but I am American, and with that comes all the trappings of success and failure. But I think the more powerful and the more enduring form of healing has been through dancing. When I say carnival is like the epitome of joy, when you really kind of connect, like it's ecstasy without ever having to get high. Without ever having to put any kind of mind-altering substances, your body naturally creates ecstasy when you are authentically connected to that moment. And when you are authentically connected to that moment, you are interacting spirit to spirit. The physical form is moving, but it no longer matters in the same way. People don't see your features when they feel your energy. When you're moving, when the music hits, like the live drums, or and it's soca and it's samba and it's baile funk and it's hip hop and it's that funky bass line, when it's jazz, it's the improvisation, it's the staccato, it's the whine. When you feel that movement, it's spiritual. And at that point, it doesn't matter anymore. And the fact that people see me and associate that kind of love and energy with me is far more healing than anything else I could do physically to my own features. The most important thing that I would want to share, and I didn't talk about this as much because I don't think it necessarily is directly related to the scars of being melanated in this country and in this world, but it is so important to me to reach out to young men and talk about embracing positive masculinity. And to femmes and women and those that are also struggling with their own perceptions about what masculinity is to embrace the notion of vulnerability. The absolute hardest part of any form of trauma I've ever experienced is the fear of vulnerability. Nothing. There is nothing that is possible. There is no healing possible. There is no growth possible if you are not willing to be vulnerable. It takes time to find those that you can trust enough to be in that space. But if you can find community, and I think it's about first being really intentional about like, what hurts you? What hurts you and why? Figure out your why. I think that's the most succinct way I can put it. Understand your why. Because once you know your why, you can then actually start having the conversations about what you're going to do about it. Part of it came through therapy. Part of it came through just the simple act of doing the intentional work of answering to myself about like, I feel self-conscious about this because of this. That's okay. And I allowed myself to be in that moment for as long as it took me. And it wasn't like an overnight thing. I don't think it was one thing specifically, but the act of self-acceptance. So that's what I would encourage anybody, male, female, unicorn, shrub, bush, squirrel, just try to get understand your why.